this is a really beautiful bookstore, and I'm really excited that we're reading here. And
thank you so much for setting this up.
Jeff totally set this up. So the book has three sections, and I think I'm going to go ahead and read a couple poems in each section. So this is the poetry secret sequence, What It Is Like to Be a Woman Pirate. Believe that it is your luck alone that keeps the fair winds blowing. Your swearing and cursing keeps the Royal Navy away. Your sea shanties cold at bay, the red sky morning. Believe that when Charon's boat appears in your scope, you will take the helm, forge ahead away from the grim silhouette. Full sail, lads, let the wind fill her belly. Believe you will always make an easy escape. Charon is only an accident boat, and you are a great man of war. A husband is a wind always blowing in the wrong direction. A husband keeps you weather-bound at port, buffeting your bow with expectations. A lover is a fresh breeze against your unfurled sails that lets you go free. A lover does not have a house for you to keep, nor a bed for you to lie in. A lover bribes the alehouse owner, leads you to the storeroom. A lover takes you to sea in a stolen schooner, invites you into his hammock. A husband is a contract you can break. A lover is an ongoing negotiation. I am the captain, but you are always the one giving orders. And the men obey you. Do they obey because you are my right-hand helpmeet, a lifeboat headed to shore to collect supplies still under my command? I crush your whole body against mine when I kiss you. Cover your mouth with my own. I won't let you breathe until I'm satisfied. I ask you if you know that on this ship you are below me. Instead of answering, you climb into the rigging to trim the sail. You tell me you sense a gale is coming. Wanted. Salty sea bitch, sea witch, musket-wielding buccaneer, scabrous strumpet given to swearing and cursing like a Jacqueline Tar, fearless female tomineer who never turtles in a storm, tempestuous mermaid siren with extensive portfolio of seductive serenades and documented history of success in compelling sailors to wreck their ships upon jagged shorelines, wind-weathered lass who can handle a cutlass, sore-fisted scrapper, loose woman with a wanderlust strong enough to match my own unnatural appetites. You sleep with your fingers coiled around the handle of a loaded musket. I sleep with my hands coiled over your breasts. You tell me I need to keep a weapon close in case of mutiny, in case of boarding, in case the lookout is caught off guard. I tell you I am a light sleeper, good watchdog. I will wake you at the first sign of trouble, and you will protect me. See, so this next one is called Anne Bonny Meditates Upon God's Law. So let me tell you a little bit about Anne Bonny, who's sort of the star of the first section of the book. She's a pirate in the 1700s. She has a rich father who disowns her for marrying a penniless sailor who ends up being basically a bit of a disappointment to her. So she meets up with Calico Jack, who's this pirate captain, and they end up going to sea, where she meets another female pirate, Mary Read, and they end up being the only two to try and resist the Royal Navy when the rest of the crew wants to surrender. So that's kind of the story arc for the first section of the book. So Anne Bonny meditates upon God's law. They tell me God's law is the law of submission. A wife submits to her husband, a husband submits to his king, a king submits to his God. This is the natural order of things. Living with my father in Carolina, surrounded by the God-given wilderness, I observed the natural law play itself out among the beasts. God intends the white-tailed deer to be eaten by the red wolf, but the deer resists the wolf when cornered wounds with its sharp hooves. The chase continues so long as the deer has strength in its limbs to fly faster than the teeth at its heels. Beastly woman, they call me. I accept the compliment. I would not place my head inside any man's noose any more than a deer would place its throat inside a wolf's jaws. I follow God's law. Let's see. This one is called Anne Bonny Plunders Mary Read's Secrets. Mary Read has never been a girl, only infrequently a woman. Still, that didn't stop her from having once had a husband. Mary had been raised as a boy by her mother to fool her grandmother into sending a crown a week, because legitimate sons need feeding and illegitimate daughters need something else entirely. Mary, what was being a wife like? I asked her. It was quiet, she says, then pulls out her cutlass, begins to sharpen and polish. What was he like, Mary? I ask. Brave, she says, and trusting, maybe a bit sentimental. The words come out fragile, as if she were pulling a moth-eaten garment from an old chest, the dusty, patient kind you leave in a distant relative's attic, filled with things you won't need, a child's christening gown or a faded wedding dress. There is no softness in Mary. When she told me she was a woman, I didn't believe her until she lifted her shirt, then I saw the layers of gauze encircling her chest as if to cover a terrible wound. I say her name as much as I can whenever the other sailors can't hear me. Mary, what kind of ship do you think we'll plunder tomorrow? Mary, which island shall we retire to after we've stolen our fortunes? Mary, do you think one day my body will hang from a gibbet in Port Royal to serve as a perch for crows? I know she hasn't had anyone call her Mary in years. Mary, after the raid on Harbor Island, every man on board must have drunk his weight in ale and then some. They're all passed out now, Mary. Reckon we could be screaming instead of whispering and still we wouldn't wake them. Mary, reckon we could be dancing a waltz on their heads and still they gurgle and snore. Mary, could you ever love a woman? Would it be easier to love her if that woman were also a man like you? So, I'm going to read a couple from the middle section of the book, which is called Fictions of Home, which is kind of fictionalized family history poems. Let's see, this one's called Ragdoll Remembers. Every aging sinkhole house has a pair of sinkhole hands, each hand clutching at savage necessities. Paper clips, paint chips, bits of broken glass, waiting for the fools to call it sincerity. Standing out on the street, the body is unmistakable. Grass is the old woman's hair, her teeth gnawed, the soil like roots. When the ground is wet, like skin on the knuckles, you can see the old woman's hands. My grandmother's hands, the antique smell of her, the bulging veins on her heatless hands. Ragdoll should have known to be rebellious, should have had blue raspberry hair, dragon tattoos all over her skin, should have possessed violently discarded clothing, kept carefully in a state of lost, should have remained unable to hide her red-striped legs, flannel-white belly. Crucial to remember the things we leave in strange living spaces, the empty cans in the closet, weak secrets turned sour and stale. She should never risk leaving the evidence in the trash. Ragdoll knows all my mother's secrets after I've forgotten or told them all already. Ragdoll knows to listen when she speaks the night to me, and the words are lost in her night delirium. Ragdoll remembers. What good little girls remember about themselves when their eyes grow small enough to catch hold of regret. My grandmother is a card shark. She deals them out, each card face down, never revealing the symbols she doesn't want read. The ragdoll is only like all ragdolls. She is frightening and friendly. Like all girls, my mother never wanted to become her mother. Remember me stammering, trying to make my words sound cool, concrete, impenetrable, less like fingers grinding into fleshy palms. Claws make the moment materialize, a sort of dizzy conviction equivocates to faith. Must be 10 years she's used that same deck, the cards now sticky and bent. The window panes grow thicker at the bases. My legs melting, my mother's sweet vinegar sobs shook our bodies. I told her, I can fix this world. I taught her to sleep. So, let's see. I'm going to read a couple from the last section, which is called Myths of the Body. Okay, this This is called When the World Inside Her Leaves Us. We take turns holding her cold, thin hands, marvel at how close the muscles and bones are to the skin. When we noticed her body becoming lighter, at first we thought she was transforming into a bird, her bones becoming hollow wooden whistles, like the spine of a kite. She was so susceptible to updrafts. From her perspective, it was the world itself that was flying out of her, fluttering off to the next well-kept garden, her skin growing fragile like the creases of a well-used map, her body revealing itself to be only a modest cocoon for something larger. "Stay with us," we whispered, even though we knew the hum of the oxygen machine was the starting of an engine too big to understand us. Okay, so this is the last one I'm going to read. It's called Interrogating Sylvia Plath. You didn't want to be a nurse, white and attendant. You wanted to be a mouth, bloodied from a fight. You wanted to be a gaping red wound. And yet you picked such a tidy way to die. Your voice buried in the air itself, in the dark baking box. I'm so tired of the Holocaust metaphor. Nazi mustaches painted on the leaders we don't like. Tax collectors as Gestapo agents. Let's take away all the casual analogies. Put them in the gas chamber once and for all. So I hope that isn't why you did it that way. I'm glad I'm not your biographer. It's hard for me not to imagine you in the kitchen of history, kneeling on the floor with your head in the oven, kneeling in your white dress, white coat, scuffing up your knees, while the other historical figures are washing the dishes, setting the table, putting on the kettle for tea. I'm trying to put into words what you meant to me. As a girl, only 14, 15, 20, 27, what you will mean to me when I am very old, when the veins pop out of my hands like angry rivers before the flood. I have things to say to you. Stand up, you stupid girl. Pay attention.